Bible was in many ways the perfect candidate for the Works Project Administration, or the WPA. The program, a New Deal initiative, wasn't just about feeding artists. It was about bringing an art of the average American to the average American. Holger Cahill, the director of one arm of the WPA, believed that art was a birthright that belonged to every American, not just the wealthy and the well-educated. The art of the WPA would be shown in post offices and libraries and would reflect the viewer's own experiences, both physical and psychological. Bibel embraced this mandate and then some. He documented the average working American on the job, in the garment industry, and on the docks.
As a WPA worker at that period, the nobility of the working men was prominent in our mind, so seeing a driller outside was very exciting.
He also responded to the rampant injustice on this side of the ocean and beyond. Foment and frustration had erupted into protests, into the fight for workers' rights and outspoken disgust for the cruelty documented in the news of the Spanish Civil War. He absorbed newspaper clippings and photographs into his work and transformed them into passionate documentation with the determination of his stroke and the fieriness of his color palette. He took a newspaper photograph of a lynching and transformed it into protest by placing the despair of its witnesses in the foreground.
There were lynchings going on that period. So as an artist, you're aware every day what's happening, so the influences were tremendous.
He did the same with images of the Spanish Civil War and with his own observation of marches at home. He filtered them through his brush or one of his other chosen media and produced something full of indignation and protest. But social realism wasn't just about documenting injustice and suffering for Bibel. It was about capturing a moment in time. And many of the moments during this period were joyous and social.
As a matter of fact, amongst the artists, we had great times together. We had a close relationship because we had two common goals, to eat and to paint.
It was a creative, dynamic period. I wouldn't trade this for anything in the world. The background for the art was tremendous. I've never changed since.
All was not perfect during these years, however. Even those lucky enough to have work couldn't count on it. The WPA fired artists as quickly as it hired them, and the program's survival was often under threat.
The word pink slip was always prevalent. We didn't know from one week to the other, well, who's going to get a pink slip?
To protect themselves against the threat of pink slips, the artists followed a growing trend of the 1930s. They formed a union. The 1930s was a time of labor organization. There was an acknowledgement that the worker alone was vulnerable, but the worker united could have a voice. When the WPA was under threat of termination, the artists took a cue from abroad and creatively resisted.
At one time, they were going to terminate the art project totally. And the artists heard that in Paris, there was a sit-in by the automobile workers. In Paris, they sat in the building. They held the building, I don't know for how many days. And the artists, you know, they were clever, very clever, said, why can't we do the same thing? And we sat in at the major office, and there were 219 of us. It's documented in many books now. I happened to be one of the 219. And the police came and dragged out the artists, two or three at a time. Some fought, some didn't. And we were arrested. And then they had a trial, and we got a suspended sentence. But the judge said, there's only one, well, we're going to suspend this, but you got to give your right name. There were too many Picassos, too many Rembrandts, too many Matisses.
Despite its setbacks, Bibel was generally inspired during this period by the energy of a camaraderie among other artists involved with the project. The artists shared exhibitions, materials, and studio space. They fed off each other and off a charged New York City. And it was that collective spirit that produced this period of supreme creativity. The camaraderie inspired Bibel's expansive and emotive documentation of New York, its inhabitants, and its most marginalized. Looking back on Bibel's 1930s work, many years later, fellow artist and friend George Siegel wrote, I was struck by how uncannily they catch the inner psyche I remember of those times. The depiction of unjust suffering, he continued, catches perfectly the fervent, almost religious idealism of the 30s. A fervor and idealism can be felt coming off the pages of a journal called We Achieve that Leon kept of his achievements in art, while his friends noted theirs in music and science. So despite the fact that times were by all accounts bad, war threatening to erupt across Europe, and poverty and racial injustice on display across the country, Bible was thriving with his $23.86 a week from the WPA, and the energy of artistic fellowship in a bustling city. The greatest art, he would later write, is produced when things go badly. In 1941, he left New York and traded in his brushes for chickens.
And I built the chicken coops, and we had over 15,000 chickens to make a living. And now for between 18 and 20 years, I did no artwork at all.
On reflecting upon his art almost 50 years later, Bible would write, "Art cannot be all abstract. It must contain nature and humanity." And so it did, from his artistic awakening in the 1930s to the end of his career, nature and humanity in abundance.